Welcome everybody to, this is my third town hall meeting in my tenure as your member representative of Congress. It's really been an honor to serve in the 112th Congress. Congress, I think most people look at as a rather significant time in our country and a rather significant Congress. I am part of a very large freshman class, one of the largest that we've had in recent history. We've dealt with 100 new freshmen, and it certainly has changed things in Washington, at least in the House of Representatives. We have done a lot of, taken on a lot of different particular issues. And there are a lot more issues that we are going to be picking up when I return next week. I think May, June, and July are going to be rather significant months for decisions on behalf of our country, our state, and in terms of what direction we plan on going. I want to talk a little bit in my opening remarks about how my first 2 months have gone, and I'd like to open it up and try to get as many questions answered as I possibly can as you take the time out of your day to come and chat with me. First, I think it's very important for me to be engaging with my constituents, making sure that I'm listening to you and try to do my best to reflect and represent the needs that you have for New Hampshire and for the nation. And that is not always going to be an easy circumstance because we've got challenging times and challenging issues, and we've got many different variables about how we want to try to solve our nation's problems. But I do offer this. I think it's time in our country where we try to look past political labels and work with anybody, regardless of party affiliation, to have results for the nation. These are certainly difficult times and trying times, but I'm very optimistic that we can, in a collegial, respectful way, try to solve the problems that we see. And I want to take ideas from all people and try to do my best to reflect those values and those needs in Washington. And while we may not always agree on every single item, I'm going to do my very best to reflect what you'd like me to do in Washington. And that includes looking at people regardless of that party affiliation label and say, let's work together, let's try to find results for New Hampshire, for our country. One of the things that our delegation, myself, Charlie Bass, Kelly Ayotte, Gene Shaheen do is meet on a monthly basis, try to find the common ground issues that we all feel are reflective of all of us and then hopeful of New Hampshire. Maybe this in recent weeks you've noticed that the Great Bay issue has been coming to a bit of a head. I had the fortune to meet with the EPA, to meet with the towns that are mostly affected by the decision that the EPA is wanting to make. And as a result of listening to both sides, I've stayed many times away to try to find areas of agreement between the EPA and the community so we can keep Great Bay pristine and clean, but do it in a financially responsible way. And I filed legislation about a week and a half ago called the Great Bay Community Protection Act, which essentially asks for, through a legislative initiative, for a five-year window for all the contiguous communities to have additional time to study science, the research that has been done on both sides, and try to come up with a reasonable plan. This is at the request of the contiguous communities who said, of course we want to clean up Great Bay. We protect it and want to continue to do that. But we also are going to be very mindful of the cost associated here in Exeter. That would be an estimated cost of about $52 million if the EPA mandates were implemented. So I did file the legislation. I'm very pleased to see Governor Lynch, Senator Shaheen, and as well as Senator Ayotte now support this initiative. We are working collectively and collaboratively on behalf of local communities right here in New Hampshire. And I think it proves a point that we can work together and look beyond our party affiliations. Look at each other as Americans first, and granted staters, and try to figure out what are the best ways and best solutions that we can help, and we can guide this country. I believe that there are other bipartisan ways in which we can properly represent New Hampshire and the country. There's so many different debates about budget, healthcare, tax policy, regulatory policy, but I was pleased that we had bipartisan support for repealing the 1099 provision in the House, passed the Senate, and it was signed into law by the President of the United States. So we sent a straight, strong message in a bipartisan way to job creators, business owners here in New Hampshire and the country, that we're going to try to be more effective and efficient as a federal government. And these are not always the stories that you hear about what's going on in Washington. When you turn on your TV at night, you'll see both sides of the aisle sometimes having a very spirited debate about how we're going to move forward as a country. But let's not forget that we have an opportunity here to have a results-driven, fact-based conversation with the country. Now, I believe that each and every one of you, and everyone in this country, deserves to know the truth about where we are in this nation, fiscally, tax policy, regulatory policy, and then try to make the best decisions to make improvements. How many people in this room feel that their parents, who are the last generation, passed off a good, strong nation? You can raise your hand. How many of you think that, given the circumstance we're in today, we can pass off a better country to the next generation? So there is some optimism in this room, that's great. But the challenges that we have are extremely significant. Morgan and I have two kids, 7 and 6, and I think quite a bit about what we're going to do policy-wise to ensure that this is a better nation for them. They have better opportunities than I have and my siblings have. I think we all owe that to the country, to the future of the country, as Americans. So the first 3 months of my tenure, I've learned a lot in Washington. Certainly think it works a little bit differently than how municipalities work, or home budgets work, or small business owners' budgets. And there are reforms that I think we're going to continue to try to implement, in addition to trying to improve different policy initiatives that we're working on. There has been a lot of discussion about spending levels in this nation. I personally believe that we need to try to reduce the spending levels that we have. We're at about $3.7 trillion in spending, and we have right now $2.2 trillion in revenue. I don't think our home budgets or our business budgets or our municipal budgets show those same balance sheets. So most people I talk to say, yes, I agree with you when you say we ought to have balanced budgets. Most people that I talk to tell me I don't support the notion of long-term deficit spending. So what I will try to do is continue to find ways to be more effective and efficient with taxpayer dollars, be about good government, effective government, bring our budget back into balance, try to prioritize our budget and determine what it is that you here in New Hampshire, across the country, people would like to see in terms of those priority levels. And then make sure we do everything we can to implement those priority levels. It's been a real honor to serve you. I do, as Senator mentioned, I'm fortunate to be back every weekend. Usually our schedule is on either ground Monday through Thursday, or Tuesday through Friday, so you're back typically for 3 days. And then once every 4 to 5 weeks, we have a district work period where we're back in district for a full week, where I get an opportunity to meet with as many people as I can. I visit businesses, I visit schools, have forums like this to try to get a feel for the pulse of what's going on, what you would like to see, again, reflected. And believe me, things change on a month-to-month basis. So I'm encouraged by the number of people who are here. I'd like to hear all of your ideas. And the only thing that I ask is that there's difference of opinion amongst us here. Let's be respectful of everybody and respect someone else's opinion, even if we disagree with it. It's part of what I think is a great thing about our country. We can come together and try to find the best solutions, the best ways in which to try to represent you. So with that, I will open it up to the first question. I think we're going to have Dave try to just ask for your name and your issue, and you can just go up to a mic and ask, and I'll try to answer your questions the best I can.
The first question is from DWR Patton from Hampton. If you could raise your hand, it's with regard to the Great Bay issue.
Well, actually, I've changed my question. My question has to do with all Ryan's Medicare plan.
The Medicare plan will end Medicare as we know it. Republicans will tell us that it preserves Medicare, that it protects Medicare. It does not. It gives us $6,000. I'm 73 years old. How far do you think that's going to go when I try to get insurance from an insurance company? If I spend more than that, I'm on my own. No help from the government at all. There's a block grants are going to the states. People say block grants, or Medicaid, is for poor people. My mother-in-law was an upper middle class woman who went into a nursing home. In very few years, all of her money was gone and she was on Medicaid. A lot of us face that. Why, Congressman Gienta, why in the world did you ever vote for the Paul Ryan Medicare plan?
With regard to restrict growth of IRS, if Dan Starr raises his hand.